Right, sir. We just talked about some of the oceanic features. After completing oceanic feature, we are just getting into this very important oceanic property, sir. You call them as salinity, or you call them as ocean water salinity, sir. Now, see, whenever we talk about salinity, first and foremost, we'll understand what is salinity. Then we'll take the definition of ocean water salinity, right? And we'll just justify that how exactly, what are the different factors which almost results in the distribution of salinity, which ranges from place to place, sir. Right, sir. Now, maybe some informal definition of ocean water salinity, we can take it. What exactly is this? Somewhere you can write it. The amount of dissolved substance present in sample seawater is called as ocean water salinity. So any substance which is completely dissolved in water, you call them as salt, and the same water you call them as saline water, or generally this concept you call them as salinity, sir. Now, when I talk about this ocean water salinity, sir, somewhere around 47 dissolved substance, known substance we have, sir. So when I talk about the number of salts that is there in ocean water, somewhere around 47 different salts are there, sir. Among this 47 different salt, what is very common, the most commonest is sodium chloride, sir. Now, in general, what is salinity? We have an idea. Now comes how exactly we define salinity and any water body, how exactly it is classified. Say, for example, you have two types of water, sir, normally. You call them as salt or saline water. And on the other hand, you have something called as fresh water, sir. Right. Now, what is this saline water? So, going by this percentage of the dissolved substance, right, whichever is having more than 3% of dissolved substance. Right, very technically speaking, it is 2.7% according to your NCERT information, but I am taking it as 3, sir. So, 3%. So, any water which has more than 3% of salt, you call them as saline water, sir. Then, what is fresh water? Any water which has less than 0.5% of salt, you call them as a fresh water. If that is the case, whatever lies in between, neither fresh nor saline, you call them as brackish, sir. We call them as brackish. So range somewhere around 0.5% to 3%, you call them as a brackish water. And logically speaking, where exactly we may find brackish water, that also we can have an idea. Wherever both this water confluence with each other, wherever fresh water and salt or saline water mix with each other, this is the place where you may look for brackish water. Finest example, delta, estuaries, backwaters, lagoons, atolls, these are the place where most of the time you find this brackish water, where the fresh water and saline water, they confluence with each other. Right, sir. Now, one more step. As we already know, when I talk about salinity, it is not expressed in percentage. We have a specific term for it. You call them as PPTs, sir. So, it is nothing but parts per thousand. What is percentage we know, what is percent we know. Parts per hundred you call it as percentage, right, per cent. Cent means century. For every hundred parts, how many parts you have, that classification you call them as percentage, right, sir. Now, how do you, that means almost convert this parts per thousand, sorry, percentage into parts per thousand, right. When I talk about the 3%, it becomes more than 30 parts per thousand. This is what the symbolic representation of parts per thousand, sir. 1% symbol means symbol followed by one extra dot, sir. Right. This is what you call them as parts per thousand. So otherwise you can also call it as 30 parts per thousand. So any water body which has more than 30 parts per thousand, right, you call them as saline water body. Right, sir. Now comes another question. What is this parts per thousand? Right. What part for what? Right. If that is the case, when I talk about salinity, right, understanding in layman's understanding or layman's way, whichever water has more than 30 grams of dissolved salt in 1 liter of water, sir, you call them as salt or saline water. Right, sir, if you are just taking 1 liter of water, putting this water to evaporation process, right? If complete water evaporates, what it will leave behind is at least 30 grams of salt. Right, so this is what you call them as saline water or salt water. The same fashion when I talk about the fresh water, sir. What exactly I do understand? So any water body which has less than 5 parts per thousand. 5 parts per thousand, you call them as fresh water body, sir, or fresh water. Right, sir, it means it has less than 5 grams per 1 liter of water, sir. You call them as a fresh water. So understanding says, even the word fresh water has salt in it. Right, sir. So there is no water on the surface without salt. So every water on the surface, precipitated water or that water what you receive by precipitation, till it reaches the surface, it may not have salt. But once it reaches the surface, right, it will be, salt will be added to it. Right, sir. And it almost comes under the classification called as fresh water. So no water in the surface is completely, right, free from salt, sir. So what is salinity? We have an idea. Right, sir. 30 grams. Any water which has more than 30 grams of dissolved substance, you call it a mess. Saline or salt water, sir. Now, another confusion or clarification is also there. One side I am just taking in mass and one side I am just taking in volume. How come you almost, means almost go for a comparison and you say percentage or parts per thousand? Make it very simple. 1 liter of water is always equal to 1 kilogram in weight, sir. And provided this phenomena do not happen in all temperature, at least at 4 degrees centigrade, this phenomena will happen. Right, sir. Right. So what is salinity? We have an idea, sir. Now, slightly deviating from this ocean water salinity, what we'll understand, we'll just talk about some of the very important saline water bodies of the world, sir. So if I talk about one of the very important saline water body of the world, or most saline water body of the world, you come across the most saline water body of the world in the name of Lake Van, sir. You are there in Turkey. You have a lake and this lake is called as Lake Van, sir. So this is the most saline water body in the world. And somewhere around 33% is the salinity, sir. When I talk about parts per thousand, it is somewhere around 330 parts per thousand of dissolved substance you have. So this is the salinity level. It means 1/3 of this water is salt. Lake Van in Turkey, sir. And when I talk about similarly placed saline waters of the world, then comes the very important Dead Sea. Almost you are there between the borders of Israel and Jordan, sir. Right, exactly between the borders of Israel and Jordan and Dead Sea. It is somewhere around 240 parts per thousand, sir. So density of this water is also very high. So whenever I talk about saline waters, they are very, very high in density. And few more water bodies, if at all, we are just adding it. We can also add this water body. Great Salt Lake, sir. This great is not there in Australia, it is there in USA, sir. And again, as a matter of clarification, just to remembering purpose, we said, whenever you come across the word called as great in a feature, you take it with Australia. Great Sandy Desert, Great Victorian Desert, Great Dividing Range, Great Australian Bight, Great almost. When I talk about a barrier reef, all great comes in Australia. But slightly deviating, whenever it comes for water body, sir, whenever it comes for lake, Great Lakes, Five Lakes, Superior, Michigan, Huron, Erie, Ontario, these are Great Lakes you call them as. Right, whenever you come across great with the lakes, you put it in USA. Similarly, when I talk about Great Salt Lake, you are there in USA, sir. Somewhere, your NCRT given information, it says somewhere around 228 parts per thousand is the salinity. Right, and one more thing, whenever I talk about salinity, salinity is not constant. Right, season to season it changes. For example, when I talk about a dry season, salinity increases. Very simple. Reason is very simple. Why exactly during the dry season it should increase? Because only water evaporates, leaving behind the salt in it, sir. So season to season it changes. Even then, we should have some value. Right, sir. If that is the case, we are just assigning some value as it is given in the popular text, sir. Some of the water bodies of the world where salinity is very, very high, we have taken it. Right, sir. Now, one part we have just missed it, but still adding it here. Whenever I talk about salinity, always I understand, when I talk about ocean water salinity in the sense, ocean water salinity always go for an increasing trend, sir. When I almost talk about the longer run, the ocean water salinity always increases. Reason is very simple. When I talk about the rivers which is confluencing in the ocean, I understand this is a freshwater. Right, freshwater dilutes the salt, no denial about it. But what happens, as and when the water evaporates, that salt is left behind and only the freshwater or only water evaporates. So over a period of time, what happens, the salinity of the ocean always it goes for an increasing order. Some exceptions are there. Temporarily, the ocean water salinity can go for a decrease. Right. One such incident which has decreased the salinity to a higher order in the very recent past, right, you yourself have an answer, you call it as termination of ice age. When I talk about termination of ice age, all that glaciers which has completely melted, it has increased the mean sea level by 200 meters. So what has increased the mean sea level by 200 meters is completely a freshwater. So more of fresh water is added, temporarily the salinity pattern of the ocean was decreased, but only then in the later stage it will be compensated and later it will become more saline in nature. So always put it, when I talk about salinity of the ocean, though temporarily it can almost go for a fluctuation, but in a longer run always it goes for an increasing trend, sir. Right. Now keeping this in mind, whenever I talk about some of the source of ocean water salinity, sir. So, when I talk about some of the very important source of ocean water salinity, the most important source, the most commonest source, which almost increases the salinity year on year, this we call it as gradation cycle, sir. What is this gradation cycle? Finest example, rivers. Right. Always remember, when I talk about rivers, on a temporary basis, river reduces salinity, but in a longer run, river adds more salt to the ocean. Why? Whenever I talk about, that's the reason I'm using this word called as cycle. Whenever I talk about gradation cycle, river takes the salt from the land, adds to the ocean, and only the water evaporates, leaving behind the salt in it. Right, sir. One of the major source of ocean water salinity is gradation cycle, sir. Apart from gradation cycle, it is a few biochemical changes. And whenever I talk about biochemical changes, at least two ways I can just talk about. One, right, it is the decomposition of the dead organic matters of the aquatic life, sir. Decomposition of aquatic organisms. Right, sir. And the salt can also be added by excreta of aquatic organisms, sir. So this can also add salt to the ocean water. And finally, to some extent, we can also almost add that salt that is added by submarine volcanic activity, sir. So these are some of the ways how exactly salt or salinity is added to the existing ocean. So it's gradation cycle, which is most commonest, biochemical changes, and of course, the submarine volcanic activity, sir. These are how the salt is added, sir. Right. So we also talked about the source of ocean water salinity, some of the most saline water bodies of the world. And one thing, always keep it in logic. When I talk about average ocean water salinity today, when I talk about average ocean water salinity, it is somewhere around 35 parts per thousand, sir. What exactly it mean, you know, somewhere around 35 grams of dissolved substance for every 1 liter of ocean water. So this is the average ocean water salinity what we have. Right. Any water body which has a connectivity with these oceans, right, any marginal water body, inland water body, if it is having a connectivity with open ocean, the fluctuation of this value will not be so great. Right, sir. So whenever I talk about highest, for example, when I talk about ocean, though I call it as average ocean water salinity, in open ocean, this value always fluctuates between 32 parts per thousand and 38 parts per thousand. Right? If that is the case, one thing I can come to in conclusion. When I talk about these water bodies, right, logic says they are no way connected with the oceans. Completely, these water bodies are lake. So whenever I talk about exceptionally high saline water bodies, sometimes you call them as a brine. Right, sir. Brine solution. Right. Extremely high in its salinity. Right, sir. They are no way connected with the open ocean. They are supposed to be a lake, inland lake, sir. Right. And one more similarity also you may find. When I talk about Lake Van, when I talk about Dead Sea, when I talk about Great Salt Lake, climatically speaking, they have one similarity. What is that similarity? Either they are confined to arid or semi-arid regions, sir. It means that they are, in general, they are located along the dry locations, right, sir, where moisture is very less, where evaporation is more, right, sir. This is where one means, climatically speaking, I have one similarity, right, sir. Right, sir, with this, all this idea, before talking about the distribution of ocean water salinity, we'll also talk about saline water bodies of India. Right, if I'm just talking about the saline water body of India, where exactly we may look for the saline water bodies, we have a very broad idea. Right, one state where I'll be looking for the saline water body, I'll be there in the Rajasthan, and particularly I'll be there in western part of Rajasthan where I have the prominent Thar desert, sir. Right. If that is the case, the most saline water body in India, we have a lake called as Lake Sambar, sir. You're there in Rajasthan, sir. Right. Apart from Lake Sambar of Rajasthan, there are few other lakes. Right. Few books says it is brackish water, few books says it is salt or saline water. You are there in the state of Jammu and Kashmir, sir. Right, plenty of lakes you come across, lakes like Salt Lake, lakes like So Murari, lakes like Pangong So. All these are confined to the state of Jammu and Kashmir. Now, which side of Jammu and Kashmir there is a possibility that you can have these lakes? See, one, when I talk about Sambar Lake is confined to tropical deserts. When I talk about all these lakes, they are confined to cold deserts. Again, logically speaking, here also I have a drier location. Right. But one thing is also there, we have already discussed in class, but reiterating this point. Right. This is a location, I know that, or we know the fact that it is almost confined to the location called as cold desert. But still, we also know the fact that this region is very much known for its glaciers. Glaciers itself is known for a freshwater reserves. Right, or freshwater sources. Now, glaciers are also there. Very near to the glaciers where I have the source of freshwater, I also have the salt or saline water bodies, sir. Now, what is the logic from where this salt came from? That also we know. Why these water bodies are salt or saline? Because of Tethys Sea, sir. See, what is today, I have in the name of Himalayas, but yesterday this region was not Himalayas. Right, sir. It was a sea. Right, that's the reason normally we say geography, nothing is permanent. A sea can become a mountain and mountain can become a sea, sir. It means it goes for a cycle. So the salt remnants what we have in Himalayas is actually originally sourced from the remnants of the Tethys Sea, sir. So that is the reason, right, why we almost identify many salt almost deposits along the Himalayan cordilleras. Right, very famous, it means nowadays it is becoming very famous, sir. You call them as Himalayan pink salt. Maybe years to come it will become very, very famous, sir. Right, sir. Some of the water bodies of India where salinity is very, very high, that also we have taken it. Right, sir, even when I talk about runoff Kutch, Gujarat as a region, there also I have saline water bodies. Right. Again, what is the similarity here? Drier location. Right, sir. Now, world water bodies we have discussed about. Saline water bodies of India also we just discussed about. Right, sir. Now, going beyond, we'll just talk about the distribution of ocean water salinity, sir. Now, from place to place, ocean water salinity differs. Right. There are different factors which determines the ocean water salinity. Logically, I can have two things. One, whenever I have addition of more fresh water, what will happen to the salinity? It will decrease. Whenever I have removal of more fresh water, right, the salinity will increase. Right. So, this is the only two logics what I am having it. Right. If addition is more, salinity will be less. If removal is more, salinity will be more, sir. Right. This is what I have to almost have it in mind. So whatever factors determine my addition or removal, I'll be taking as a factors which is responsible for the distribution of ocean water salinity. Maybe I can write it as factors influencing the distribution of ocean water salinity. Factors influencing the distribution of ocean water salinity, plenty are there, but to almost have in decreasing order, first comes the latitudes. Because I understand you increase the sign of latitude, what happens to the temperature? Temperature decreases, right? Again, if temperature decreases, what will happen to the salinity? Salinity also decreases because the removal of water is very, very less. So first comes latitude. Now, is it acting only on the basis of latitude? No, there are many factors coming into picture. Mean sea level, I don't have a concept called as altitude. Why? Water type of balancing. Right, sir. Completely only one level. That's what you call them as a mean sea level. Altitude does not play any important role here. Right. Apart from latitude, right, sometimes, for example, equatorial region. For example, if I'm just considering only latitude, which region will have the highest salinity pattern? Undoubtedly, it is equatorial region. But in reality, I don't have equatorial region having high salinity. The reason is very simple. Because equatorial region, we have a precipitational surplus. Right, sir. If that is the case, what else is going to affect the factor of salinity is precipitation, sir. Right. So, one latitude we have taken it, one precipitation we have taken it, sir. Apart from latitude and precipitation, we also have the factor called as continentality. Continentality. Right, sir. Now, what is this continentality? Sometimes you call them as effect of land, sir. Effect of land on water. Right, sir. Now, whenever I talk about continentality, the same latitude, continental water body will be having a different temperature and open ocean will be having a different temperature. Whenever I have a higher temperature, salinity will be more. Whenever I have a lower temperature, salinity will be less. Apart from continentality, I also have the effect of ocean currents. I also have the effects of ocean currents. And finally, when I talk about the factors, right, it is influx of fresh water. So whenever I talk about influx of fresh water, two popular ways of influx of fresh water I have. Number one, it is rivers. And number two, it is ablated water or the process called as ablation. Melting of glacier, you call them as ablation. So these are the factors which may determine the salinity profile of any ocean in general, sir. Now, one by one, we'll just take it. When I talk about latitude, sir. When I talk about latitude, latitudinal distribution. At least this latitude I can divide into four categories, sir. So let me divide into four categories. One, you are there in equatorial waters. 0 degree somewhere around you are there in equatorial waters. 30 degree you are there in tropical waters. 60 degree you are there in temperate waters. And 90 degree you are there in polar waters. Not exactly 90 degree, it means you are there in higher latitudes, you are there in lower latitude, and you are just dividing this mid latitude into two categories, that is tropical and subtropical, sir. Now, only one exception, we'll just take it. Average ocean water salinity, when I talk about average value, what is the average value? You know, average is somewhere around 35 parts per thousand, sir, 35 parts per thousand. And only one I have to remember, equator is the region or equatorial water is the one where I have low salinity profile, sir. When I talk about low salinity profile, the value is somewhere around 34 parts per thousand. Slightly, I am just taking the value. This value is completely logical. Right, sir. So, equatorial region, it's an exception. Right, why it is an exception? Why I call it as a low salinity? Because precipitation surplus you experience. Right, two factors I am taking hand in hand. Right, apart from equator you just take it as an exception. Now, you apply the fact. Right, or you apply the logic. What is the logic? You increase the sign of latitude, precipitation decreases, and of course salinity, right, increases. Not only precipitation decreases, temperature also decreases. Excuse me. Right, you increase the latitude, temperature decreases, as the case, salinity also decreases, sir. So if that is the case, highest salinity is experienced in tropical water, sir, highest. So if I'm just assigning the value somewhere around 38 parts per thousand, I'm just assigning it. Temperate, it is high, somewhere around 36 parts per thousand, and polar, it is lowest. Ablation of glacier is very high in polar region, so it is somewhere around 32 parts per thousand. So this is how, from latitude to latitude, the salinity differs. So when I talk about the highest, highest is confined to the tropical waters. Right, sir. Now latitude, along with the latitude, indirectly in equatorial region, we have also added this concept of precipitation, sir. Now along with the latitude and precipitation, if I just talk about continental water bodies, sir. Now, generally when I talk about continental water bodies has a dual character, sir. For example, when I talk about continental water bodies, will this continental water bodies will be warmer or colder? We cannot say so because it is latitudinal dependent. Say for example, when I talk about continental water body of lower latitude, what will be the temperature there? In comparison with open ocean, it is warmer. Finest example, Bay of Bengal, Arabian Sea, Gulf of Mexico, they are warmer. If that is the case, continental water bodies in lower latitudes, what will be the salinity profile? High, right, sir. If that is the case, we will understand in this way. When I talk about the continental water bodies, of lower latitudes, sir, lower latitude, it will experience high temperature. If it experiences high temperature, it will experience high salinity. If you are there in higher latitude, because water has a dual character, sir. Water maintains temperature. Water is just not warmer or colder. Water is almost, it maintains in temperature. Right, sir. If that is the case, when I talk about continental water bodies of higher latitude, it will be having low temperature, sir. If it is having low temperature, salinity will be low, sir. Now, the second extension. Among the latitudinal waters we have seen, tropical water has the highest salinity among the open ocean. Now comes another question. We have different continental water bodies in tropical land. If that is the case, which water body will have the highest salinity among the water body which is connected to the open ocean? You yourself can find out, putting yourself in tropical latitudes. Whichever water body is more continental, that will have the highest salinity profile in the entire world, sir. Among that water body which is connected with the open ocean. You may put yourself in world physical or world political, whatever it is. You are there in tropical latitudes. So you're just away from equatorial region, sir. By 10 degree to 30 degree, you just almost travel along this latitude, both in northern and southern hemisphere. Southern hemisphere, hardly you have any continental water bodies, except this Gulf of, or this Mozambique channel, right? We do not have continental water bodies. But when I talk about the northern hemisphere, plenty of continental water bodies you have. Water bodies like Gulf of California you have, Gulf of Mexico you have Arabian Sea, you have Bay of Bengal, and you also have the extension of Arabian Sea in the name of Red Sea, right, sir? Bay of Bengal you have, and few Gulf region in South China Sea and others also you have, sir. Now comes the question. Among the following, which is the most continental water body? It is Red Sea, sir. So when I talk about among the continental water bodies, or put it very simple, any water bodies that is connected with ocean, which has the highest salinity is Red Sea, sir. It is somewhere around 42 parts per thousand, sir. And if that is the case, which water body will have the least salinity which is connected to the ocean? Any continental water bodies that is there in the polar region. This is what the logic is. Right, sir? If you are putting yourself, when I talk about the least salinity level, you are there in Baltic Sea, sir. Almost the value fluctuates, but when I talk about Baltic Sea, it is somewhere around 20 parts per thousand, sir, approximately. Very high fluctuating value, but still it is for different reasons. Ablation of water is very high, and the confluence of rivers are also very, very high in this region, Baltic Sea. Where to look for Baltic Sea? You are there in Europe, sir. You are there in Europe, almost on the verge of this polar it's being a polar water, very near to this North Sea, sir. Just morning class, we have just seen this North Sea. Very near to this North Sea, you can find this Baltic Sea, sir. You are there in Europe. You may find this Scandinavian countries, sir. They're almost there along this coastline of Finland. Sweden and Finland, sir. Exactly between Sweden and Finland, you can find this Baltic Sea, sir. So, Baltic Sea is that water body which has the lowest salinity among the open ocean constituent or continental water bodies, whatever it is, which is connected to the ocean, sir. Right. Latitude, we have justified. Precipitation, we have justified. We have also justified the concept of continentality with this. We also know the fact that which is the most saline water body of the world, which is connected with the ocean, right? And in similar phase, right, which is connected with the ocean but still very less in its salinity, that also we have taken it, sir. And finally, few more facts we'll just add it. Now comes to the concept of ocean currents, sir. How exactly ocean currents can influence? When I talk about ocean currents, there are two types of ocean currents again. What are they? Depending upon the temperature, you call them as warm current and cold current. Now, see, linking pin, we have plenty of linking pin, but make it very simple. Right. What type of climatic condition is associated with warm currents? What type of climatic condition is associated with warm currents, sir? Wet conditions. What type of condition is associated with cold condition? It is dry condition. If it is wet, what will be the salinity pattern? Less in salinity. If it is dry, it has more salinity. Now comes the question. Irrespective of the ocean, any ocean of the world, say for example you are there in Atlantic Ocean, exactly between the South Americas and the Africa, right? Which coastline you will be having a higher salinity, sir? Will it be African coastline or American coastline, sir? Simple question. You are there in South Atlantic Ocean, right, comparing the coast of South America with Africa. Right, along the same latitude, you are there in the tropical waters, but which tropical waters will have higher salinity? Is it African coast or American coast? African coast. Reason, I have a cold current called as Benguela current. So wherever I have the cold currents influence, there all I'll have salinity very high. Right, see one thing, most of the time where we confuse. Cold current, you say evaporation is less. You say that salinity should be less. No, take the forward linkage again. Right, that's the reason we said cold current is not, okay, fine, it is known for less evaporation, no denial about it, but more than the less evaporation, it is also known for arid condition. Warm current is known for heavy evaporation, accepted, no denial about it, but more than the evaporation, what it gives you is the precipitation surplus. Right, that's the reason we talked about concepts like El Nino, La Nina. Not El Nino and La Nina, even tomorrow, means today morning we talked about the concept called as desert. Right, every desert is associated with what type of a current? Cold current. That's the reason we say cold current, right, results in dry condition. Right, directly put it very simple, sir. Cold current results in dry condition. Right, sir. Warm current results in wet condition. Right. And finally, when I talk about influx of fresh water, sir, more is the influx of fresh water, what will be the salinity pattern? Salinity pattern will be less. Right. This is simple logic. Now, finally, taking one final concluding line, sir. If I am just putting myself in map of Asia, I am just comparing Bay of Bengal versus Arabian Sea, sir. Bay of Bengal versus Arabian Sea. Map of Asia, comparison can be almost done. Because when I talk about Bay of Bengal versus Arabian Sea, which water body is more continental in nature? It is Bay of Bengal is more continental in nature. Reason, that is the reason why we say when I talk about cyclogenesis, including Fani, which is almost crossing Orissa line now. Right, almost it is having a landfall now. When I talk about Bay of Bengal is known for high temperature. Why? Bay of Bengal is more surrounded by land. Right, sir. Now apply the concept. When I talk about the salinity, which one will have more salinity? Is it Bay of Bengal or Arabian Sea? It should be Bay of Bengal, but the fact says it is Arabian Sea. Now comes the question, why? When I talk about temperature alone, it is Bay of Bengal. But salinity is not the case because, right, more than the evaporational loss, it is compensated by the rivers that is confluencing in Bay of Bengal. When I talk about the number, more than the number of rivers, when I talk about the volume of water which is confluencing, it is plenty. Or when I talk about, it means extraordinary volume of water almost confluence with Bay of Bengal. Right, sir. That's the reason all these facts in isolation, it should not be considered, sir. One fact alone will not act. Always, I have plenty of different factors acting hand in hand. Right, when I talk about Bay of Bengal, continentality is also working. Influx of fresh water is also working hand in hand. When I talk about equatorial region, why it is known for its low salinity, it is latitude, and again, hand in hand, it also acts with precipitation. That's the reason. One factor in isolation should never be considered, sir. Right. So with this, we are just concluding this concept of salinity, sir. One very important ocean property we have taken in the name of salinity, sir. Right. From salinity, moving to equally important topic, it is called as ocean water movement. And one of the most important movement comes in the name of ocean currents. Right. Ocean current is a true movement of water. Like a river that flows, I have the surface and subsurface water almost moving in a continuous direction for a prolonged period. You call this as a current. Somewhere as a definition you can take it, what is a current? Large scale movement of ocean water, large scale movement of ocean water, both in surface and subsurface, in a particular direction, and for a sustained period is called as ocean current. So continuously this current almost moves. Right. How many implications also we can have? For example, though almost this example, a very popular example always I take it. A motorcycle that was washed from Japan during a tsunami was actually identified on the shore of Canada, sir. Right. It means completely it was taken from Japan by tsunami. But when I talk about this bike was identified in the coastline of Canada. Now comes the question, what has transported it? Right, sir. Now, what has actually transported it is this current. Right. Not only this almost event, many such events we have. For example, again, the very popular connotation, we almost talk about this ghost ship, sir. Without the crew, I'll be having a ship which is drifting along the coast. Parallel to the coast, it'll be completely drifting. Right, sir. And crew will not be there. What is actually driving this ship is not actually the ghost. Actually, what I have is the current that flows. Right. A continuous movement of water, right, that flows along the coastline is the one which almost results in these kind of incidents. Right. And this mechanism or this process, normally you call them as a current. Right, sir. Now, what is a current? We have an idea. Now, when I talk about this current, definition itself says both surface and subsurface. It means two types of current you come across. One, that current, what you find it in your atlas, what is represented, you call them as surface currents. Normally, what is logical, what is not shown, but still what is understandable, you also have similar types of movement of water, large scale movement of water, right, in the name of upwelling and downwelling, you call them as subsurface currents. Now, when I talk about this surface current, generally the surface current is called as gyre circulation, sir. Any closed circulation in the surface, you call them as gyre circulation. Similarly, when I talk about the subsurface current, we call them as thermohaline circulation, sir. Right. And again, when I talk about this thermohaline circulation, we come across two types of thermohaline circulation. One, where there is a rise of water, you call them as upwelling, sir. And wherever I have sinking of water, right, we call them as downwelling. Normally, warm waters go for upwelling because of density. Right. And low salinity water also goes for upwelling, because again it is density. Whenever I talk about high saline waters and colder waters, they go for downwelling, again because of density difference. Right, sir. And when I talk about the surface currents, we have two types of currents. One, you call them as open currents, and you call them as boundary currents. You call them as a boundary currents. And this open current or boundary current can either be a cold current or a warm current, sir. All combinations are possible. It can be a cold current or it can be a warm current, sir. I have plenty of cold boundary current, I have warm boundary current, I have cold open current, and of course we also have a warm open current, sir. Right. Now what is very important? What directly results in climatic patterns? What almost results in coupled ocean atmosphere phenomena is this surface current. Right. For example, when I talk about phenomena like El Nino and La Nina, what affects El Nino and La Nina? Surface current. What affects Indian Ocean Dipole? Surface current. Surface current plays a very important role. Or I would say, when I talk about the current which is influencing the desert in its almost, right, increasing the aridity, in, means aridity nature of a desert, again you are there in a surface current. Surface current plays a very important role in determining the climatic pattern of any part of the world, sir. So what is very important for us is this surface current. Right. So what is a current? We have an idea. What are the different types of current we have? Now only thing is that we should know the locational aspect of the current and factors which is responsible for the genesis and sustenance of the current is also very, very important. Now what we'll do? We'll just go for the surface current. We'll try to construct the surface current, sir. Right. While constructing the surface current itself, we'll just take the reasons for the sustenance and the genesis of the current, and we'll just try consolidating all the factors which is responsible for the same, sir. Now, you can directly put yourself in this currents map, sir. World climate map. And again, like trenches, remembering current is very, very easy, sir. Again, you will find all these currents takes the name of the coast itself. Say, for example, when I talk about this Geyer circulation, only 5 Geyer circulations we have. Where exactly we have this Geyer circulation? One, you find it in North Atlantic Ocean, complete circulation, South Atlantic Ocean, North Pacific Ocean. North Pacific Ocean in your atlas, you may not find it as a circle, because one side it is bifurcated, right? The other half you will be seeing in the other side, sir. Right. And similarly, you also find it in the South Pacific Ocean, North and South Pacific Ocean. One closed Geyer circulation, you also find it in Indian Ocean, sir. So 5 Geyer circulation we have. 2 in Pacific, 2 in Atlantic, and 1 in India. Every current you take it, they take the name of the coast itself. Forget about the open current. What is a open current and what is a boundary current? Any current which flows along the coastline, along the boundary of the continent, you call them as a boundary current. Whichever almost current flows from one landmass to another landmass, you call them as a open current. Finest example, open current, equatorial current, north equatorial current, south equatorial current, they are open current. If you are there in southern hemisphere, you may find one current. It is called as west wind drift. Sometimes also called as circum-Antarctic drift. They are open current. Now when I talk about boundary current, they take a very specific name, sir. If you are there in Americas, irrespective of the ocean, put yourself in North America. Pacific Ocean coastline of North America. What is the current you have? It is called as Californian current. Why it is called as Californian current? Because I have California state, I have California peninsula, I have Californian Gulf. Right, sir. When I talk about the eastern side, Atlantic Ocean, what is the name of this current? You call them as Gulf Stream. Why it is called as a Gulf Stream? Gulf of Mexico. Gulf of California, I call it as a Californian current. Gulf of Mexico, I call it as, Gulf Streams. Right, further you extend the Gulf Stream. It is called as North Atlantic Drift. Northern part of Atlantic Ocean, I have the wind dragged movement, I call them as a drift. Right, it takes a specific name. Right, sir. Further, you almost extend this North Atlantic drift, this current extends in the form of Norwegian current. Why Norwegian current? Because Norwegian Sea is there. Right, sir. It almost moved towards Norway. Right, where I have a Norwegian Sea. Right. It is named after the location itself. Similarly, you are there in South America, sir. You are there in South America. If you are there in Pacific coastline, what is the name of this current? Peru current. Sometimes it is also called as Humboldt current. But when I talk about the popular reference, it is referred as Peru current. Very rarely it comes as the Humboldt current. Now again, why Peru? Peruvian coast. Right. When I talk about the eastern side, what I have? Brazilian current. Falkland is a minor current. Again, I have an island called as Falkland. When I talk about the major current, Brazilian current. Again, Brazil country. Every current takes the name of the coast. So like trenches, currents are also easy to remember, provided you know that where exactly this particular location is almost identified. Now, few currents, not so prominent, but still named after the right almost places. For example, when I talk about Benguela, sir, you're there along the African coast. Right, I have a current called as Benguela. Benguela is the name of a place, a very minor place. Right, in Africa, it is called as Benguela. When I talk about Canary current, northern part of Africa, Canary is an island which belongs to Spain. Right, sir. When I talk about this island, again, after this island, this current was named. Right. Only thing is that these locations are lesser known, but still named after the locations. Right. So with all this idea, what we'll do, we'll just try constructing these currents again, right, in a fast forwarded fashion, sir. Five oceans, or five gyre circulations we are just taking. Are not needed. You may maintain the same in your atlas itself. If at all few currents can be added in your atlas, you can add it, sir. Now, imagine that almost you are there in India, sir. You are there in Atlantic Ocean here. You are there in Pacific. And of course, you are there in Indian Ocean, sir. You are there in Indian Ocean. Now, wherever you are there in, sir, and assume that this is equator. If you are there in equatorial region, right, I have a surplus water. Whenever I talk about the salinity profile of this equatorial water, it is very less. So normally I have the rise of water. This is called as a surplus region, sir. Now, whenever I talk about this equatorial water, one thing is there. Equatorial region is not known for any wind, because equatorial region itself is known for a special term reference. You call them as doldrum, sir. What is this doldrum? Region of absolute calmness, sir. Region of absolute calmness. Whenever you say calm, what exactly we mean by calm in chapter of climatology? Right, no wind. Right, sir. Because I don't have any wind, wind do not play a very important role here. Right, sir. So what exactly plays a very important role here in the sustenance and the genesis and the sustenance of this current is the rotation of the earth, sir. Because earth is rotating, right, from west to east fashion. Right, I have this current which almost moves in an opposite direction, that is east to west fashion. Just because of the rotation of the earth, we have few movement of water that is experienced. Right, sir, completely it is because of rotation of the earth. It is exactly causing the water to move in the opposite direction. Right, sir, it moves from east to west. Right, that water which moves from east to west, right, in equatorial region, it is called as equatorial current, sir. Right, it is called as north equatorial current in northern hemisphere, and south equatorial current in southern hemisphere. But complete east-west fashion, this current generally moves. Now, when I talk about this equatorial current moving towards the western side of the continent, I understand this is not the continuous water body what I have. Sometimes this moving water encroaches or almost it is almost stopped by the shoreline of a barrier. Right, whenever it is moving, it always encounters a landmass in itself. Now, whenever I talk about it almost encountering a land, wherever it almost enters the shoreline of barrier, part of this water, surplus water, almost gets retraced back in the original latitudes. You call them as counter equatorial currents. You call them as counter equatorial current. Now, what has actually resulted in north and south equatorial current is spin of the earth. What has resulted in counter equatorial current is the water surplus region. Because water is surplus, part of the water is retracing. Why I have the surplus water which is created? Because two equatorial currents are converging at this place. Right. Now further, the currents are not over, sir. When I talk about Atlantic Ocean, imagine this Atlantic Ocean north equatorial current striking the coast of Americas, particularly South America. Part of this water is almost transferred to the higher latitude in the name of Gulf Stream, sir. Gulf Stream. And once Gulf Stream water almost reaches the westerly belt, right, what is the movement of this westerly wind direction? It is southwest to northeastern direction. The same fashion, this westerly as a wind further takes this current further to the higher possible latitudes in the name of North Atlantic Drift, and further it takes the same westerly belts, takes further in the name of Norwegian currents. It takes in the name of Norwegian current. Right, sir. Similarly, when I talk about South Equatorial Current striking the coast of Brazil, part of this water is transferred to the higher latitude in the name of Brazilian currents. It almost transferred in the higher latitude in the name of Brazilian current. Same fashion, when I talk about Indian Ocean, sir. Indian Ocean, South Equatorial Current striking the coast of Africa, part of this water is transferred to the higher latitude in the southern hemisphere. It is known as Agulhas Current, or very popularly it is called as Mozambique Current, sir. Either you call them as Agulhas or Mozambique Current. And similarly, when I talk about North Equatorial Current striking the coastline of Asia, part of it, because of the shoreline barrier, part of it converts itself into Kuroshio Current. Further, this Kuroshio Current, when enters the westerly belt, it is further dragged by North Pacific Drift, sir. And finally, the last warm current what we have, when I talk about South Equatorial Current striking the coast of Australia, part of it is almost transferred to the lower latitude, sorry, higher latitude in the name of East Australian Current, sir. The name of East Australian Current. So these are the exhaustive list of warm currents what we have. And now comes an idea. Whenever I talk about warm currents, sir, where exactly you find warm currents? Two ways. If this warm current is an open current, you find it in lower latitudes. Right. If this warm current is a boundary current, you find it in the western side of the ocean. And always remember, current reference point is ocean. Whenever it comes with a continent, then what is west of continent becomes east of ocean. Finest example, I have western part of Pacific Ocean, right, but name of the current is East Australian Current, because eastern side of Australia, right, sir. So only two places you find warm current: open current in lower latitude, boundary current in west, right, sir. So that's the reason we said, just remember only this current. That's the reason we have taken west is warm, sir. Right, with respect to the oceans also we have taken it. So western side of the ocean is always warm, right, sir. Now if this is the case, only thing is that we have to conclude with the cold currents, sir. Now if you are there in cold currents, westerly belt of the south, sir, or southern hemisphere, what is the flow direction of westerlies? You know, west to east. If that is the case, this water is completely dragged from west to east, right, by this wind, right. Accordingly, this current is called as west wind drift, sir. This is one current, or this is the only current in the world which circumnavigates the entire earth, at least in that latitude. No current circumnavigates the entire earth, but when I talk about this west wind drift, it circumnavigates the entire earth. That's the reason it is also called as circum-Antarctic drift, sir. It's called a circum-Antarctic drift. So it just encircles the entire Antarctica, or it encircles the entire earth. What is the reason for its encirclement of the earth? Because you do not have a shoreline barrier, complete latitude, right? What I have is the dominating part of the oceans, right? But still, when you come across some very small piece of land, for example, if you're there in Atlantic Ocean, the southern peninsular tip of Africa diverts part of this water to the lower latitude in the name of Benguela Current, sir. Similarly, the peninsular tip of Australia near Perth almost converts, or this almost transfer part of this water to the lower latitude in the name of West Australian Current. And finally, when I talk about the peninsular tip of Chile and Argentina, transfer that dominant portion of this cold currents in the name of Peru or Humboldt currents. Peru or Humboldt current. Right, sir, this is how the currents of southern hemisphere may always look like. To conclude the northern hemisphere, when I talk about North Atlantic drift on almost reaching the northern part of Atlantic Ocean, part it is almost transferred to the lower latitude in the name of Californian current, excuse me. It is called as Canary current. And similarly, if you are there in Pacific Ocean, part of it is transferred to the lower latitude in the name of Californian current, sir. So this is the complete list of currents what we have, all major currents we have taken it. So while almost constructing, we have taken few names, what can be the potential reason for it. Right, sir. Now, along with these currents, with major currents, you can also add a few minor currents to it, sir. For example, already we talked about George Banks and Grand Banks, sir. When I talk about Grand and George Bank, we said that it means at least one cold current and warm current confluence with each other. Right, from this Labrador Sea, we have almost this current which is confluencing, you call them as Labrador currents, sir. And similarly, when I talk about the Greenland side, you have a current, sometimes it is called as East Greenland current, or very popularly it is also called as Irminger current, sir. A current called as Irminger current, in your atlas it is given as East Greenland current. And similarly, if you are there in South Atlantic Ocean, a minor current, exactly between the island Falkland and mainland Argentina, you have this current. This current is called as Falkland current, sir. See, all these names are there in your atlas itself. To make it very simple, instead of taking this diagram, in your atlas itself, few marking, you can take it. You can make it, sir. And finally, to end the last list of minor current, you're there in Asia, sir. Right, you may find one current from the Sea of Okhotsk, it confluence with the North Pacific Drift. It is called as Okhotsk current, sir. And very near to Okhotsk from Bering Sea, you have a current, it is called as Oyoshio current. It's called as Oyoshio current. So this is the complete list of all gyre circulation, including the minor currents, sir. And again, let me reiterate this point. Every current is named after the coastline itself. Where exactly lies the difficult? Difficulty may almost rise in remembering minor current, sir. Right, sir. Kuroshio, Oyoshio, given the name, right, somewhere you are there near Japan, sir. Right, somewhere you are Japan, almost somewhere you can logically, you can associate. When I talk about Labrador, I understand Labrador is a very famous sea along the Canadian coastline, sir. Right. Falkland, again, you are very sure that Falkland is an island, very important island. Geopolitically also, it is very important. You are there almost in the extension of this peninsular tip of Argentina, sir. If that is the case, what exactly you have to remember? You may remember Irminger current. Right. Sea of Okhotsk also you can remember. So what I understand, only Irminger current, if you remember, that is more than enough. And among the major currents, what you may remember is only two, sir. That is Canary current and Benguela current. Almost all other currents takes the name of the popular coast. So it means remembering may not be a problem, sir. So only if these two currents you remember, it should be sufficient. Right. And finally, when I talk about the factors influencing current, When I talk about equatorial current, sir, what exactly has resulted in equatorial current? What exactly has resulted in equatorial current? It is the rotation of Earth, sir. And whenever I talk about a rotation or spin of the Earth, one force always comes into picture, that is Coriolis force, sir. And one thing we know, when I talk about Coriolis effectivity, what is the effectivity of Coriolis force in northern hemisphere? Deflection is towards right. Right, 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 and right. You will find that almost water goes for clockwise circulation in direction. Any ocean you take, if you are there in northern hemisphere, always you find that circulation type is clockwise, sir. Right. If you are there in southern hemisphere, almost the deflection is towards the left. Right, sir. So left, 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 and left, you'll be having counterclockwise in direction. That's the reason always we say any circulation you take in northern hemisphere, it will be clockwise. Any circulation you take it in southern hemisphere, it will be counterclockwise. But one exception is there. What is the exception? Cyclones. Direction of cyclone is completely different. That is also Coriolis force. But when I talk about cyclone, right, cyclone is completely. That means the indirect effect of Coriolis force you will be experiencing with cyclones, sir. Just almost having funny is having a landfall, right? If at all, if I'm just talking about funny now having a landfall, I can understand that direction is completely counterclockwise in direction, sir. So cyclone is the exception. Apart from cyclone, what I understand, every other circulation in northern hemisphere will be clockwise. Southern hemisphere will be counterclockwise, sir. Right. Now, factors influencing current, at least two things we have taken it, rotation of the spin, sorry, rotation or spin of the earth, whenever it comes in, Coriolis force always comes in, sir. Apart from Coriolis force and rotation of the earth, third, very important, where majority of, or I would say, this is the major factor in the genesis and sustenance of currents. Right, sir, even in Indian Ocean side, we have two currents, but temporary currents. You call them as southwest monsoonal drift and northeastern drift. Right, sir. Now, what is that? When I talk about the third very important factor, it is prevailing winds, sir. Prevailing winds plays a very important role. North Pacific drift, North Atlantic drift, west wind drift, all this, whenever you come across the word called as drift, drift means wind dragged movement of water. So wind dragged movement of water, you call them as a drift, sir. Right. Prevailing winds plays a very important role, sir. Now, apart from prevailing winds, on what occasion North Equatorial Current has become a Gulf Stream? Put it very simple, you call them as shape of coastline, sir. Sometimes you can also call them as coastline barrier. You can also call it as a coastline barrier, sir. Coastline barrier, or you can call them as a shoreline barrier. Right. So rotation we have taken it, Coriolis force we have taken it, prevailing winds we have taken it, shape of coastline we have taken it. Is there any other factor that we have left? Thermo and haline, sir. When I talk about thermo, it is temperature. Temperature also plays a very important role. And apart from temperature, when I talk about saline, salinity, salinity also plays a very important role. Be it temperature or be it salinity, indirectly it is affecting what? Density, sir. Right. So density also plays a very important role. See, temperature or salinity, indirectly it is affecting the density. That's the reason density I have just taken as a, means taken as a separate point. Because if at all, if an examination, if they ask about density, right, you can also add density in it. Right, sir. And again, in class I would have added this word, but here I am not adding this word. Right, so this word is called as etc. Right. The reason, again, now most of the time I insist on this word because let us not confine that these are the limited factors which is almost acting on ocean currents. Why I say etc.? Because etc. is the word which has saved me. When I talk about the reason for counter-equatorial current, the reason is not added here. What is the reason for counter-equatorial current? Convergence of the, right, currents. Right. Where exactly we have added etc.? That's the reason I have just also added this word called as etc. But in the terms of UPSC, somewhere, in terms of UPSC, one thing is there, they have not taken revolution, sir. So, according to UPSC, revolution do not, a revolution of earth, sir, I'm talking about, revolution of earth, do not play its role in genesis of ocean currents. This is a point also we would have taken it. Why I am insisting? According to UPSC, it has almost regarded that revolution do not play any, its means any of its role in almost the genesis and the sustenance of ocean currents. Right, sir. This also has a point, you can take it. Right, sir. Some of the factors about ocean currents, we have taken it. What should not be included, revolution, we have taken it. Right, sir. That's the reason indirect effect we are not taking into consideration. Only whatever it is direct, we are taking into consideration. Right, with this, almost the major part of currents, we have done it. Only few basic comparison between cold and warm currents, we'll just take it, sir. One side, you can write it as warm current. And another side, you can write it as a cold current, sir. Some basic difference between warm currents and cold currents, we'll just take it, sir. Now, when I talk about warm currents, somewhere you can write it, warm currents or swift currents. Warm currents or swift currents. You know the meaning of swift current. What is swift current? Fast moving currents. Within bracket, you can write it as fast moving currents. Cold currents or sluggish currents. Slow moving currents. Right, sir. Further, you can write warm currents. Warm currents are narrow but deep currents. Warm currents are narrow but deep currents. It means width of this current will be very less, but when I talk about the depth of the current, it will be considerable, sir. When I talk about the cold current on another side, sir, right, they are broad current but shallow current. Cold currents are broad currents but shallow in nature. Further, you can write, warm currents are located either in lower latitude or along the western side of the ocean. Whereas cold currents are identified either in the higher latitudes or in the eastern side of the ocean. Further, you can write, warm currents are normally known for wet weather profile, whereas cold current is known for inducing arid conditions. Cold current is known for inducing arid conditions. Right, sir. Some basic difference between cold currents and warm currents also we have taken it. Right. So what are the currents? Where all we have the currents? What are the forces which is responsible for the genesis and sustenance of the current? Right, sir. Everything we have taken it. And here, two exceptional current, we'll just take it. Two ways or two exceptional current we may come across, sir. One, it is a Norwegian current, and two, it is Peru current, sir. Here itself we can take it. Why I am just insisting on Norwegian current and Peru current, right? Now, why I am insisting on Peru current, let me understand. When I talk about Peru current, We have different cold currents. Different cold boundary currents are there, sir. Canary, Benguela, West Australian current, Peru current, and Californian current. All these are cold currents. Among the five cold currents, which is the coldest current I have? Peru current. Somewhere we have taken it. Just because means Peru current is the coldest current, Atacama doesn't happen to, means Atacama doesn't happen to be the driest desert. Somewhere as a fact you can take it, Peru current. Among the cold boundary current, Peruvian current is the coldest current. Among the cold boundary current, Peruvian current is the coldest current. Why Peruvian current is the coldest current, we know. Because Peruvian current is that current which is transferred from the highest possible latitude. Right, sir. All other are almost transferred from the so-called lesser latitudes in comparison with Peruvian current, sir. Right. On the other hand, when I talk about Norwegian current, why Norwegian current is very important, that also as a fact you can take it. Among the warm currents, you can write it as a para, among the warm currents, that current which reaches the highest possible latitude, among the warm currents, that current which reaches the highest possible latitude is Norwegian current. So Norwegian current is the only warm current which reaches the polar latitude, sir. Right. Now if that is the case, what is the advantage, or I would say, it means what is the geographic importance of Norwegian current? For example, when I talk about the polar region, particularly during winter, sir, complete polar region becomes completely frosted. Right. This polar region is not navigable during this winter season, sir. It means entire northern part of Europe, if Norwegian current would have not been there, it would have not been navigable, sir. But just because Norwegian current's impact is felt in northern part of Europe, what happens even during peak winters, the northern part of Europe do not completely freezes. Right. Northern part of Europe is the only place in the same latitude which is not frozen during peak winters. What is the reason for it? Norwegian current. If that is the case, Norwegian current acts as the gateway for northern coastal regions of Europe, sir, particularly during winters. In your own words, you can write this importance of Norwegian current. Norwegian current checks that the northern part of European seas do not freezes during peak winters. So only two currents we have taken. Peru current importance we have taken, Norwegian current importance we have taken it, and one more importance is also there, sir. For example, morning we talked about British type of a climate. You are there in temperate regions, sir. If I talk about temperate latitudes, three types of climate we have identified with the temperate latitudes, sir. That is British type of a climate, steppe, and Manchurian type or Laurentian type. Now comes the question. Among the three types of climate, which is the warmest climate? It is British type of a climate. What makes British type of a climate to be warmest? It is Norwegian current. Right, sir. Norwegian current. Again, what makes British as a warmer region is Norwegian current, sir. Now with this, we are just completing the currents aspect, sir. And the last topic in oceans, it's called as tide, sir. The last topic, a very small topic, you call them as a tide. Now, wave and tide should not be confused. What you happen to find as a rise and fall of the water in a localized perspective, you call them as a wave. Wave is a wind dragged movement of, or I put it this way, movement of energy, you call them as a wave. But whenever I talk about tide, sir, whenever I talk about tide, or I put it this way, whenever I talk about wave, even if you are there in the ocean, open ocean, assume that you are a sailor, right? You are there in the middle of the ocean. Even then, what you can find is a wave, but in open ocean, you cannot feel a tide. Now, what is a tide? Entire ocean put together, if it is rising, entire ocean put together, if it is falling, you call them as a tide, is it? Right, as a definition, you can write, what is a tide? The bulge or pulse. The bulge or pulse. The most accepted definition. One more definition says the rise and fall of water, but still to be more technical. The bulge or pulse that is created along a longitude in an ocean or a sea. Is called as tide. So this is the most accepted definition what we have. Furthermore, description, if you want, you can write one more sentence or one more para. The rise and fall of local mean sea level. Due to the gravitational attraction induced by sun or by moon is called as tide. So what is a tide? We have an idea. So whenever the entire water rises, sir, imagine that this is the localized mean sea level, what I say. The localized mean sea level rises. Now assume that this is the new mean sea level, what I have, localized mean sea level. Every day this phenomena happens at least twice, or I put it this way. It means two high tide and two low tide, completely four times I'll be experiencing this phenomena. Entire mean sea level rises, you call them as a high tide, sir. Entire mean sea level falls below, you call them as a low tide, sir. And the difference between the high tide and low tide, you call them as a tidal range, sir. Tidal range. And the global scenario, this tidal range is not more than few centimeters, sir. Few centimeters. But few places, this tidal range is very, very evident. For example, when I talk about places like Bay of Fundy, Canada, right, I understand this tidal range is somewhere around 15 meters. Right, put it into feet, approximately somewhere around 50 meters I have. Right, 50 meters, almost the height of 5-story building. Right, every day what I understand, 4 times the water will rise, or I put it, 2 times, twice the water will rise and twice the water will recede, sir. So every 6 hours and 13 minutes I can find this water is rising and find this water is falling. Right, sir. You call them as a high tide and low tide. Now comes the question. Why exactly this water rises? Because this is the place where I can have moon or sun exactly placed like a head sun position or a head moon position, where the gravitational attraction of this lunar object or this sun will be induced on the surface of the water. So water will rise. Water will rise to that level where there is an equilibrium maintained between the gravitational attraction of Earth and the gravitational pull of the celestial bodies. Till that level, it will rise. When sun or moon almost gets dislocated from this place, the water which has risen will fall, sir. Right, sir. This is what you call them as a low tide. When the water rises, you call them as high tide. When water recedes, you call them as a low tide, sir. So what is a tide? We have an idea. Now slightly adding one or two technical words. Whenever there is a high tide, sir. Whenever there is a high tide, right. Imagine that this is normal level of sea, sir. This is normal level of sea. Whenever there is a high tide, what happens? Whenever there is a rise, this water will start moving towards the coastline. So this is the period when sea will start inundating towards the land area. That water which starts moving towards the land area, you call them as a flood tide, sir. Or sometimes it is also called as a flood current, because I have the movement of water itself. So this is the time when you will see that water starts moving towards the coastline. Right, sir. You call them as a flood tide or flood current. And during the low tide period, what happens? All that water which has come to the land area will start moving towards the ocean again. You call them as an ebb tide, sir. You call them as an ebb tide. So technically, both these terms can be included. What you experience during a high tide is a flood current. What you experience during a low tide is an ebb current. Onshore effectivity, flood tide. Offshore effectivity is ebb tide, sir. Right. And here also I can almost understand what is a shoreline and a coastline. Right. Whenever I talk about the fluctuation, shoreline is the one where I'll be having the fluctuating nature of this, right, almost the fluctuating nature of the sea level, sir. Right, shoreline will change from time to time. And the highest limit where shoreline can have its on-land effectivity is coastline. Whenever I talk about high tide, coastline and shoreline becomes one, sir. When I talk about low tide, there is a maximum distance between shoreline and a coastline. Somewhere, what is a coastline and shoreline? If you want to take it as a definition, you can take it. Permanent transition between land and water. Permanent transition between land and water is called as a coastline. Whereas, the land and water transition, at any given point of time is called as shoreline. One more point you can write. Shoreline and coastline overlaps, shoreline and coastline overlaps during the period of high tide. Whereas, the distance between shoreline and coastline is maximum during a low tide period. Right, sir. Right. Now, what is a tide? We have an idea, sir. Right. Now, on what occasion we'll be experiencing a tide, that also we'll just take it. Imagine that means slightly it is over exaggerated representation, but still to understand this tide, we'll just take this representation, sir. Right. Now, whenever you have a moon, sir, which is almost inducing its gravitational attraction, right, there I find that water is almost pulled to the maximum level. Wherever I have the head moon or head sun position, right, sir. See, whenever sun is pulling the water, you call them as a solar tide. Whenever moon is pulling the water, you call them as a lunar tide. Now, both creates a tide. Now comes the question, which tide is more effective in nature, which tide is more almost higher in its orientation? It is lunar tide. Reason, not because of the size of the celestial body, but it is because of the proximity. Right, lunar tide is at least 4 times greater than that of a solar tide. Right, sir. So whenever I talk about tide, though there are 2 different types of tide, tide in general simply means a lunar tide. Right, sir. So wherever I have this head moon position, I'll be having a high tide which is created, sir. Now, Earth has its own rotation. Uniformity of the rotation has to be maintained, I understand one side alone you should not have a bulge. This bulge has to be compensated in equal amount in the opposite direction also. What you call them as antipodal location. Right. Exactly on the antipodal location, the equal and opposite bulge is also felt. It means at any given point of time, right, Earth will experience 2 high tides together. One high tide is created by gravitational attraction of the moon. Another high tide is created due to the centrifugal effectivity, sir. One is almost created due to the centrifugal effectivity. So any given point of time, what you understand, two high tide is created at the same tide. Right, one, due to the gravitational attraction on one side. Opposite side, in order to maintain the equilibrium, equal bulge is created. You call them as high tide because of centrifugal effectivity. So two places I have high tide. If two places, if I have a high tide, I understand at some place the normal level of the sea should go down. Right, where the normal level of a sea is going down, you call them as a low tide, sir. You call them as a low tide. So any given point of time, Earth will experience two high tide and two low tide together, sir. Together. Right, it can be with respect to the sun or it can be with respect to the moon. Right, wherever I have head moon position, I'll be having a high tide. Wherever I have this centrifugal effectivity, there also I'll be having a high tide, sir. Similarly, when I talk about the perpendicular position to this place, you'll be experiencing a low tide, sir. If we assume this is Earth, over exaggerated representation, but still, just to justify that there is a bulge of water. Assume this can be a moon or it can be a sun. Right, whenever I have such effectivity, wherever it is having the effectivity, two places I experience high tide together and two places I experience a low tide together. If tide's effectivity would have not been there, assume that effectivity is completely uniform. So without tide and without the effectivity of the celestial body, this is how the normal condition may look like. Whenever I almost take the effectivity of these mean celestial body, right, this water may bulge, right, in the given look, means in the given format, sir. For example, right, two high tide. As you know that one high tide is created due to the gravitational attraction. And another high tide is due to the centrifugal effectivity, sir. Right, sir. Now, what is a high tide? We have an idea. What is a low tide? We have an idea. Now, we said any given point of time, we experience two high tide and two low tides, sir. Now, let us forget about the solar tide. We are just taking only the lunar tide, sir. Right, sir. Or I put this way. Assume that I'm just talking about a lunar day. Now comes the question, what is a lunar day? Or when I talk about solar day, what is a solar day? Right, sunrise to sunrise of two consecutive sunrise, you call them as a lunar day. When I talk about solar day, when I talk about the lunar day, what exactly is lunar day? Right, moonrise of today to moonrise of tomorrow, you call them as a lunar day. When I talk about lunar days, it is somewhere around 24 hours and 52 minutes. It means every day moon comes 52 minutes late. This is what the understanding says. For example, if you have a moonrise at 6 p.m., next day, moon will rise at 6:52 p.m. Right, this is what the understanding says. So, lunar day is somewhere around 24 hours and 52 minutes. Right, sir. If that is the case, in one lunar day, one particular location, how many high tide and how many low tide it will experience? Two high tide and two low tide, sir. So, in this period, it will experience two high tide and two low tide, sir. Now comes another question. What is the time period between? When I talk about that, time between two high tide or two low tide. What is the time between two high tide or two low tide? It is 12 hours and 26 minutes, sir. Right, sir. It is 12 hours and 26 minutes. Further, when I talk about the time between high tide and low tide. What is the time between one high tide and low tide? It is 6 hours and 13 minutes. That's the reason we said every 6 hours and 13 minutes we have the rise and fall of water. When the water is rising, water will start moving towards the coastline. When water is falling, water will start moving away from the coastline. So every 6 hours and 13 minutes, you have this rise and fall of ocean water, and this is due to the tidal effectivity of moon, sir. And at the same concept, if I just ask you, what is the time difference between a high tide and low tide during a solar tide? What can be the time difference between a high tide and a low tide with respect to the sun, sir? 6 hours, right? Solar day, 24 hours, right? Almost a time difference between two high tide or two low tide with respect to sun is 12 hours. If that is the case, what I understand, right, rise and fall of water with respect to sun happens once in 6 hours, right? But still, what is very important for us is this lunar tide, sir. So what is a lunar tide? We have an idea, right? Every 6 hours and 13 minutes, we have this lunar tide which is happening, right, sir? So what is a tide? Right, sir. And what exactly, how this sea may look like during this season? A very common sight in Bay of Fundy, sir. Low tide, completely land get exposed. High tide, almost water fills the complete region, sir. Bay of Fundy, where almost, when I talk about the rise and fall of water, it is somewhere around 50 feet, sir. Again, how exactly a place may look like during a high tide and place may look like during a low tide, sir. So if at all, if you are just water phobic, once the water recedes, you can walk on this land, sir. Right. Now, India also, we have few places. For example, last year, it was there in your question paper, a beach called as Chandipur, sir. Chandipur is known for this phenomenon, right? Map itself, if you're there in Orissa, right, regional map, you will find dotted lines which is given. Every year what happens, every high tide and low tide, it means water recedes a few kilometers, right? See, the rise and fall of water is only minimum, but if this slope is very, very gentle, right, what happens if it is very shallow, water completely recedes to the maximum levels, right? Chandipur is the finest example. You can put yourself in a map of Orissa. Physical or political map, you will find this dotted lines given, sir. And the tidal range is very, very important for harnessing this unconventional energy resources from the ocean, what you very popularly called as tidal energy, sir. Barrages of this kind is almost constructed whenever flood current, using the flood current, a turbine will be rotated, and using the ebb current, again the turbine will be rotated, sir. So flood current and ebb current, or flood tide and ebb current, means ebb tide, helps in tidal energy conversion, sir. Right. So everywhere in the world, this tidal energy is used for almost producing electricity or energy, sir. But when I talk about India, Stambeshwar Mahadev Temple, they claim it is a rare phenomena, but without knowing that it is a common phenomena everywhere, right, sir? So low tide, you can almost have your darshan. High tide, others will be having your darshan, sir. Right, sir. Now, so this is very common in Gujarat, sir. Almost you are there in Gulf of Kambath. So phenomena is this high tide and low tide, sir. Not only that, so when I talk about similarly, sir, when I talk about Haji Ali Dargah, sir, Haji Ali Dargah also similar almost phenomena takes place. Haji Ali Dargah can be accessed only during a low tide period, sir. Right, high tide period you cannot access, but now you have all weather or all season roads, right, connectivity. Otherwise, these are those religious centers which has almost taken, right, at least almost believed in this tide as a concept, sir. So low tide, water recedes. High tide, water occupies. Right, sir. Now, what is high tide? What is low tide? We know. And finally, one more concept we'll add it. Whenever I talk about tide, we said tide can either be caused by sun or it can be caused by moon, sir. Sometimes what happens? Sun and moon almost acts, right, in almost cooperation with each other, sir. Right, sometimes they almost complement each other, sometimes they contradict each other. Right, sir. Whenever sun and moon almost goes for almost interchanging their role, or it means if they complement each other, right, you have two different types of tide which is created. You call them as spring tide and neap tide, sir. So when I talk about spring tide, sometimes it is also called as sisgi, sir. It is also called as sisgi. Right, you also have another type of tide which is called as a neap tide, sir. It's called as a neap tide. It is called as quadrature. So spring tide and neap tide, sir. Now what is a spring tide? Spring tide will happen wherever sun, moon and earth, almost they are there in a straight line, sir. When exactly sun, moon and earth is placed in a same line? Only two occasions, sir. Either it will be a full moon day, or it will be a no moon day, but rather very popularly it is called as new moon day, sir. So either it will be a full moon day or it can be a new moon day, sir. Right, sir. So these are the only two occasions where I will be having sun, moon and earth placed in the same line. Same line. Now, how exactly the spring tide may look like? So whenever I talk about spring tide, sir, spring tide, sun, moon and earth, almost they fall in the same line, sir, same line. So what happens? Whenever I talk about sun, moon and earth, for example, imagine a condition. I have earth, just above earth I have moon, just above moon I have sun. So what happens is water will be pulled by moon to some extent. Now sun says, I'll also help you out. Further, this water is almost being pulled, sir. Now what we find here, it means sun and moon goes for complementary effort. Right, sir. Already it is a high tide created by moon. Now this high tide is further pulled by sun. So it makes the high tide highest tide, sir. So what you experience during a spring tide is the highest tide, sir. So it is not just high tide. Let me call it as a highest tide. If high tide is highest, what will be low tide? Lowest. Right, sir. So high tide is highest and low tide is lowest. And when I talk about tidal range, what will be the tidal range here? When I talk about tidal range will be maximum, sir. Tidal range will be maximum. Right. All others are combinations. Why I say combination? When I talk about this highest tide, what is creating the high tide here? It is the gravitational attraction of moon plus centrifugal effectivity of sun. When I talk about the high tide which is created here, what is almost creating the high tide here? It is a centrifugal effectivity of moon, which is very high, plus gravitational attraction of sun. It is combination. Whether it can be gravitational attraction or it can be the centrifugal effectivity, but both complementing each other. Whenever both complements each other, you call them as a spring tide. Right. Almost you are there having on a full moon day and this on a new moon day, sir. So when I talk about high tide created here, what is creating the high tide? It is gravitational attraction of moon plus gravitational attraction of sun. And similarly on the other side, it is gravitational attraction of, it is centrifugal effectivity of moon plus centrifugal effectivity of sun. See, this much is not needed, but just to tell you that both complements each other. Right, sir. So wherever both are complementing each other, what you experience is a spring tide. Very popularly, the spring tide is also called as cis geese. On the other hand, when I talk about neptide, now what is this neptide? Both contradict each other. So whenever this moon almost results in a high tide, this high tide is slightly reduced by the solar tide. So moon, for moon, it's a high tide period, and for sun, it is a low tide period. So whenever the effect of one is almost reduced by another, you experience a neptide, sir. Sometimes also called as quadrature. It's also called as quadrature. Why it is called as a quadrature? Because it is almost experienced in first quarter and the third quarter. Whenever sun, moon and earth comes perpendicular to each other. So when I talk about neptide, also called as quadrature, right, it experiences or it happens when sun, moon and earth are placed perpendicular to each other. Right, sir. Now finally, when I talk about the high tide during a neptide, what will be the high tide? This high tide itself will be low. So that's the reason you call them as a low high tide. What will be the low tide? It will be high low tide. If that is the case, what will be the tidal range? Minimum, sir. So when I talk about tidal range during the neptide, it is minimum. Tidal range during the spring tide, it is maximum. So independently, we have seen what is a solar tide, what is a lunar tide, what is very effective is lunar tide. Sometimes combination of lunar and solar tide also we have taken it. What do you call them as a spring tide and neptide? Spring tide, tidal range is maximum. Neptide, tidal range is minimum, sir. So with this, we are also completing this tides as a concept, sir. With this, oceanography we are completing.